So what started, what led you into making beats and into music?
I started as a DJ. It's a funny story about, like, to kick a pre-story. Like, where I'm from upstate, I was 13, there was no DJs up there, so I fucking bought two Radio Shack turntables and trying to figure out how to DJ. So fucking the only person I knew DJ was, I would tape the Def Comedy Jam Kid Capri, you know, the first ones, and I would fucking rewind them, and there'd be the segment where it'd show him scratching, and I would try to figure it out. It's crazy that I ended up getting with him and signing with him later.
That
and then
crazy.
Even crazier was me and him did all the music for the Def Comedy Jam 07-08 season.
Really?
So yeah, it was like some weird fucking like full circle.
So DJing, mm-hmm. what led you to DJing? Before you got to that, what was your DJ name? Because everybody has a good first DJ
name.
Oh, man,
funny name. Daddy Wicks.
All right, Daddy Wicks.
Hell yeah.
I don't even want to know why you picked that name.
Well, everybody called me Wicks. Yourself.
Okay.
Yeah, that was like my childhood nickname.
Daddy Wicks on the ones and twos.
You know what I'm saying?
That's cool. So how do you get into beat making? Like, was it like, did you grab like a PC or like?
Oh, yeah. I actually started with, I bought this like, I forgot what it was called. It was like a Roland sampler first. And then when I was 17, I ended up fucking just saying, fuck it, and I copped a MPC. It was my first thing. And then I got a keyboard. And then I used to just mainly sample in the beginning because I didn't know how to play music and stuff like that.
Oh.
So I ended up teaching myself later, and I could play now and everything, you know, multiple instruments and stuff like that. But it was, it was experience. And like I said, my first year of college, I ended up fucking getting right out of high school. I ended up hooking up with some Def Jam people, sold a beat to LL. And I ended up meeting my manager now, it was Tiki. He was signed to Def Jam, and it was just crazy. I ended up doing two joints with LL, got robbed, A&R took my money. I was young, dumb, stupid, like just happy to be in the building, you know?
That's always the case. Was LL the first beat you sold?
Official beat?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, okay. That's
and then this is a funny story, man. I don't care, you know, it's been so long, but it was like, it was two songs. One, he put Cisco on the hook. And it was when he was Dong Song and all that shit with mm-hmm. Pop. And the other one, he put 112 on the hook. And then it was supposed to be on the Rush Hour 2 soundtrack, both of them. And A&R was like, kind of boxed me in the corner. It was like, either you're going to sign to me or the songs ain't going to come out. And I was like, mad nervous, man. So I went upstate and I got like a family lawyer. I was like, you think I do this to you? He was like, nah. And I was like, nah, I'm not signing. He pulled the records off and shit.
Coming into the business, like, you're brand new, like you said, you're just happy to be there, mm-hmm. but then you start getting into the reality of the business.
Yeah.
Like, when did you start taking it, like, seriously? Like, okay, I'm happy to be here, but it's time to get my lawyers, get my publishing, like, when?
Shortly after that, to be honest with you, I was working with another producer from upstate at the time, and we came down, we found this battle rapper down here named Shells, and we ended up doing all his demo music. And it was kind of, that's when I ended up getting with a lawyer, and she's been with me since. But she kind of introduced me, like, it was right after Shells, because Shells got signed to J Records, I got jerked again. So right after that, one of my mutual friends was like, I know this young lawyer, she's gonna, you know, look after you, and I hooked up with her, and ever since then, I've been cool. Okay. Yeah.
So for producers that's coming up now, because, you know, now there's a lot of producers coming in the game, and that's like bottom level, mid-level, how important would you stress, like, no matter what level you're on, you should get your things in order, like paperwork and stuff like that?
It's the most important thing, to be honest with you, especially at this time in the music industry, because it's so, like, people are so thirsty for money because the money kind of, you know, dried up a little bit for producers and writers and stuff like that. So everybody's just sharks, you know what I mean? And there's people now that are, like, not even writers and producers that are, like, they're the middleman to the A&R.
Okay.
And when you bring it to them, they're even trying to get a piece of the publishing and writing and all kinds of crazy shit.
That takes the fun out of it.
Yeah, and if you ever see a song that has like 12 writers on it, there's probably only like 4 or 5, and everybody else is just people that are attached to somebody or something, and it's like they get a piece of the pub. It's just crazy.
So comparing the game back then to right now, do you think it's easier for producers, or do you think it's like in like 50-50?
It's definitely easier. Because, I mean, anybody can put the, you know, shit on SoundCloud, YouTube, you know, there's a million fucking...
But what? No, go ahead, finish.
I was just saying, there's like, and it kind of like, the quality control kind of lost, though, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I was about to ask that.
I tweeted something one day, and I was just like, you know, imagine how good the quality of music would be if it cost $500 to post on SoundCloud or $500 to put your video on YouTube, because everybody would be like, well, maybe I won't put that.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Think twice
they would like, you know, they would get it done right and really do it and be like, all right, I'm really going to put this out. You know what I mean? Like,
and I think